This video is part of the Cybersecurity Challenge Germany 2020. IntroPwn is a series of memory corruption challenges which are hosted on some server, and you need to exploit the binary to gain remote code execution and read the flag file from that server. I will show here a potential solution for the first part, Pwn 1. The second part of the challenge is a small variation of the solution, and the third part is adding another small twist. If you are just starting out, this video could already be a bit advanced, but I still recommend you to watch it to get an idea about the goal. I link a lot of resources that are more or less related to this below, so you can study. This is a complex topic at first and does require a lot of time dedication to absorb everything. So don't worry, it takes time. Now let's head in. This is a Linux exploitation challenge, but I'm solving this challenge on my Mac. To do this, I'm using a workflow using Docker, which I have introduced in previous videos, which are also linked below. So the provided files contain three folders for each stage, Pwn 1, Pwn 2 and Pwn 3. We will solve Pwn 1. You can also see a Docker Compose YAML file, which can be used to run the challenge for local testing. It basically runs a local server. The makefile shows how the challenges were compiled. Inside of the Pwn 1 folder, you can find the test flag, the Pwn 1 binary, the Pwn 1 C's source code, and Ynet D, which is just a server to host the challenge. So let's type docker compose up, which will build the three challenge containers and run them. Once that is done, you see with docker ps the three containers running. The service is exposed via port 9100, 9101, and 9102. But pod 1 is 9100, so we can use netcat to connect to it. Enter your name, the name is printed, and then enter your magic spell, and that's it. As I've introduced in some Docker videos before, I'm using here this CTF container to develop the exploit. Now this container is also running, and we can use docker exec to get a shell in it. And now we have a Linux environment to create the exploit. Let's have a look at the Pwn 1 source code. Here at the top you see that the program was compiled with disabled stack protection. But it's better to use the tool checksec to see the actual mitigations of this program. So we can see it has full rel row, no stack canary, non-executable stack, and PIE, which means ASLR for the binary. Now back to the source code. If we check main, we see it first calls these ignore functions. They are called ignore me because they are just setting some stuff up to make the challenge work but are not important for exploitation, so feel free to ignore them. The important functions here is welcome and afterwards AAA. It should also be surprising to see this unused Wingardium Leviosa function, which simply executes a shell. The capitalized win is a hint that you somehow have to redirect code execution to this function to win. If you are able to execute this, you get a full shell, thus you have remote code execution and can access the flag file on the server. This challenge has already a few exploit mitigations turned on, and it's not super straightforward to solve. But I have made a video about a much simpler challenge, which is also linked below. I want to explain to you now how I approach this challenge and what kind of mental model I'm building. So, the program starts in main. Now let's find the first interesting place, and that's obviously gets, which reads a string of arbitrary length from the input into the buffer here. The buffer is a local variable, so stored on the stack, which means we have a buffer overflow vulnerability here. So this is what I'm thinking. We start at main and eventually reach a dangerous gets. This gives us the ability to overwrite data on the stack due to the buffer overflow. Now, in my mind, I go through typical data stored on the stack, and the return pointer is such a critical value. If you overwrite it, the function will, when it returns, jump to whatever address you have overwritten it with. Which means we could theoretically overwrite it with the address of Wingardium Leviosa. But we have a problem, because from checksec we know the binary is compiled with position-independent code, PIE, which means it's affected by ASLR. We don't know the address of the win function in memory. There's actually another small exploitation trick. You might not need to know the full address. You could also try with a partial overwrite and thus kind of cheat your way out of ASLR. But I want to see if we have another option before I try that. So for now, this avenue seems useless. We don't know the address. The next interesting function is printf, because our user input is directly passed as the first parameter to printf. This gives us a so-called format string vulnerability, which means you can enter format modifiers such as %p, %x, %s, or %n into the input. If you don't know what they do, simply look up a basic C programming tutorial how to print variables with printf. Under the hood, printf simply assumes the variables you want to print with these modifiers are written into registers or placed on a stack, depending on how much you try to print. Which means we can, for example, use %p or %x to leak arbitrary values from the process, more specifically the stack. Let's test this. We start the program, it asks for the name, and then spamming a few %p, and now it prints the name, where it then interprets those %p, and you can see how it leaks a lot of hex values. You can even find here our own input, because our buffer with our input is on the stack and we leak stack values. The AAA are here, the hex 41414, and the BBBB is here, hex 424242. Another cool trick with a format string vulnerability is using %s. That prints a string. It's implemented in a way where printf expects a pointer on the stack and prints the data wherever it points to. Because we see our own data here on the stack, we could place an address on the stack and then use %s to read the value wherever it points to. So we can not only leak stack data, but read arbitrary data. However, this again requires us to know valid addresses, so ASLR stops us from abusing this. However, of course, there are small tricks here too. Maybe there's already some useful address on the stack that you can simply reuse, but that's again a rather creative and uncertain technique. For now, we assume we can't do that here. There's another format modifier that is useful, it's %n, which is kind of the reverse of %s. This also expects an address on the stack and then writes a number to whatever that points to. The number is the amount of printed characters, so it's somewhat a write anything anywhere, but because of ASLR, we don't know valid addresses. Not useful. Which means that leaves us with leaking values from the stack, and that might be useful. Now what do we do next? Well, when we follow the code, we can see that eventually it asks for a magic spell where it uses the unsafe_gets function again. So we have again the ability to overwrite data on the stack. And of course, we could again try to overwrite the return pointer, but because of ASLR, it still doesn't help us. But wait, things are different now. At this point of the execution, we had a printf before, which allowed us to leak values from the stack, which means we might be able to leak a randomized address, which defeats ASLR. We can then calculate the random address of Wingardium Leviosa and overwrite the return pointer with it. And then we won. We would get a shell. This seems to be a pretty good plan, so let's implement it. I'm creating now a Python script, exploit pwn1, and I'm using the Python library pwntools to make a lot of stuff easier. If you use the Docker workflow, it's already installed there. So from pwn, import everything. And then I start by developing an exploit locally. So I'm starting a new process of the pwn1 binary. You need to make sure you place the script in the same folder. And then for a quick test, we can call pinteractive to get an interactive input output shell. In the terminal, I then use docker exec to get a shell inside of my Docker container and move to the folder where the challenge is in. Here I can then execute the script, and you can see here pwntools creates a nice shell for us where we can send input and read the output. So we can, for example, enter the format string %p where it asks for our name. Cool. From our mind map, we know we first want to leak data from the stack, so let's write some code for that. First of all, we want to read the output of the pwn1 process until it asks for our name. So receive until enter your which name. And then we use sendLine to send our malicious format string. I'm using Python list comprehension to quickly create a format string of my desired length. It will be pipe separated, 32 times the %p for now. And then we can switch again to interactive. We can test it. It runs, we get the output. The data leaked from the stack nicely separated by pipes. So this means we can now use receive until again to read output until we are asked for the magic spell and then split that string by the pipe. This gives us basically an array or list of the leaked data. Printing it so you can see. Let's run it. Here's a list of leaked data now. We know from our mind map that we need to leak an address that corresponds to an address of our binary, so something that also points into the code, in order to defeat ASLR for it. But looking at the leaked data, it's not easy, without educated guesses and experience, to see which could be such an address. So what we can do is we can use GDB debugger to help us with that. The process is still running because it waits for our magic spell input, so we can attach to it with gdb-p and getting the process ID of that pwn1 process. And then let's look at the virtual memory map of this process with vmmap. Here you can see the memory start and end addresses where our binary is placed. So the whole binary as it is loaded into memory here. So there is no shuffling of addresses inside of the binary. ASLR only affects where the memory starts. So the first few bytes of the address here are random. So any address, in this case, starting with hex 5614 would be our binary. Let's look at the data we leaked from the stack. Can we find such a value? Actually, doesn't seem like it. So maybe we didn't leak enough values. Let's try it again with more percentage %p. Run everything again, here's the leak. Let's attach GDB and get the virtual memory map again. And now we look for addresses that start with hex 55CA. And indeed, we can find now one in our stack leak. If we are curious, we can check what that address is. So disassemble at this address. It turns out it belongs to the main function of our program. Actually, it points here, right after the call to welcome. So this is actually the return pointer that was pushed onto the stack when the welcome function is called. And when welcome returns, it will return to this address and continue execution here. Cool. Now we have defeated ASLR because we know one address from our binary. And this allows us to calculate any other address we want. In our case, we need the address of the Wingardium Leviosa function. So where's that one? With printing that, we can find it here. And now we can do simple math. This address minus this address gives us this offset, hex 135. And we can add that now to our exploit. So main to win offset is hex 135. The main address we leak is the fourth item from the back, so leaks minus 4, and it's a hex string, so we need to convert it to an integer. And then we can calculate the win function address by subtracting the offset from main. Awesome! Now we move on to the next part of the exploit, the buffer overflow, which is caused by the gets in the AAA function. First of all, we want to find out the offset, how much input we have to provide until we overwrite the return pointer. To do that, we can create a unique sequence pattern that we can use to easily calculate it. It's also known as a de Bruijn sequence. I'm generating here a sequence that is somewhat longer than the buffer is defined. Before we send the hopefully crashing input, we can add a raw input which pauses the Python script here until we hit enter. This gives us time to attach GDB to see what happens. So let's run it. It's waiting now before it sends the payload. We attach GDB, continue, send payload. Oh, no buffer overflow happened? What? Let's look at the code again. Oops. See here, I was too fast. I wasn't walking slowly and carefully and didn't properly analyze the situation. Here's a check, and that input has to be Expelliarmus. If it's not the magic spell, we run into an exit, and that function terminates the program without ever returning from this function. So even though we overflow the buffer here at the gets, because we never return, it doesn't matter. You might wonder how we can still send a long payload if it requires this short string as a password. But there's a trick. String compare expects strings to be null terminated, and gets actually doesn't stop at null byte when reading our input. So we can easily prepend our cyclic pattern with the Expelliarmus password followed by a null byte. Now let's try it again and attach GDB. There we go. Now we crash. And we can see here on the stack our unique pattern. The return function tried to read this value from the stack and use it as an address to continue execution there, but that failed. With this string, we can now calculate the offset, how much padding we need to reach the stack value. Cyclic find is the function that, given the string, calculates that we need 251 bytes. So we can make a string of 251 A's. After the padding, we can now control the return pointer, which we obviously want to point to the Wingardium Leviosa function. P64 is a function that takes an integer and packs it into an 8-byte raw string, so we can add the address after the padding. Let's try it out. To make sure it works, I attach GDB again and trigger the overflow. We ran into a seg fault. But if you look closely, you can see that the seg fault is happening inside of win. So we did successfully redirect code execution, but we run into the same issue of the system function as described in a previous challenge video I made. It's all linked below. We need to use the same trick again. We need to make the stack pointer aligned so it has a zero at the end. So we add another gadget to our exploit. I'm just using the return of the win function, which has an offset of hex 36 from the start of win. So we can now define a red address by calculating win plus hex 36 and add that before the win address. This should work now. I'm changing the exploit from the local process execution to talk to the remote challenge server by using the IP and port. In this case, it's the local challenge server we started with Docker Compose at the start. Let's run the exploit against it. This didn't seem to have worked. Crap. Let's just try again. Fingers crossed, it was just weird stuff. Okay, now it worked. We have a shell. We are the CTF user on the challenge server and we can read the flag. Excellent. Now go ahead, try to recreate the same exploit for the first part of the intro point challenge. This is the solution here, but you need to execute it yourself to get the real flag. And when you have done this, then move on to part 2 and part 3, which are very similar but slightly differ and make it a little bit more difficult. So you need to do some additional research and experimenting. As I mentioned, a lot of resources are linked below, and don't worry if you don't get it. It's hard at first and requires a lot of practice and suffering. Suffering and frustration is a huge part of hacking. Now, good luck.